Achievers, welcome back. Welcome back to your Easy Achievers Gaming Podcast for the week of September 4th. Already September 4th in the year 2020. I'm one of your hosts, of course, Elijah. Sitting across from me, of course, is Alex. How are you?
I'm good. How about yourself?
I just had a pizza.
Pizza?
All right. It was a DiGiorno. It's nothing crazy. This is
a DiGiorno. There's nothing wrong with that. I love DiGiorno. God, no. Especially the rising crust.
I think that's what I had.
That one's good.
I think that's what I had. It was delicious,
though. It's like really thick in it. Like there's like a lot of marinara on it.
God, you said thick with such enthusiasm, and I love it.
It's thick, like with two C's.
Yeah, two C's. Thick. All right. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, DiGiorno is very good. Very good. Alex, you got two options. You go to the DiGiorno's, or do you like what is your more likely to do? Get a DiGiorno's or order out?
Before I would get Pizza Hut, but now ever since I've had this DiGiorno Final Crust, I don't order a pizza out anymore. I just buy this one.
DiGiorno's.
It's probably been over 6 months since I've even gotten order out pizza.
Ooh, 6 months. It's been a while for me. Probably not 6 months, but it's been a good while since I've gotten like an order of actual like pizza. Now we do live in Georgia. Mm-hmm. They weren't out known for great pizza. Being frank, I don't think I've had a fantastic pizza here. But I have had amazing pizza in in Savannah. Mellow Mushroom, phenomenal.
Yep, I was just about to say that.
Phenomenal pizza. I mean, really, it's mm-hmm. it's amazing. You go there, you get like they're like really specialty. You'd call them, Alex, right? Like a specialty pizza.
It's like
everything's like a special pizza.
No, for sure. They have like so many different types of things.
I think right, one's like all mushrooms. One's like garden. Like they're all special stuff. You can't really. You're not really supposed to like. Can I have pepperoni? Like you're not really supposed to do that. You get like crazy like meat-a-tastic some shit.
Yeah, you're supposed to order something that's crazy.
It's fantastic though.
It's like the Cheesecake Factory. Like when you go there, you don't order just like a small little thing. You start ordering a bunch of.
You bring up shit. The Cheesecake Factory. What are your feelings on this?
No, that's expensive though.
What are your feelings on the Cheesecake Factory? First off, why do I have the Bible as a menu? What's going on with this? This thick ass menu. I'm not gonna order the spaghetti meatballs, Cheesecake Factory, okay? Take that off. Like take off the things no one's ordering that much food, right?
Like and it kills me because you go to the Cheesecake Factory because you're thinking, I'm just gonna order cheesecake. That's what I'm here for. But then you get to the list of the crazy foods that's there, and I'm like, then I can't even make up my damn mind.
Alex, so when I first went to a Cheesecake Factory, and it's always built up because that's like the default sitcom place, right? Mm-hmm. You would agree, like that's where you go for, like any sitcom would go for like a restaurant. It's just Cheesecake Factory for whatever reason. That's what it is.
Okay.
In your experience, Alex, what is the Cheesecake Factory? Because to me, when I had it, it was just a cacophony of random foods on a menu, and then I got really mm-hmm. good cheesecake at the end.
And yeah, to me, it's just like a super expensive, always busy, fancy restaurant.
No, I definitely wouldn't put fancy anywhere near that. But yes, I agree. It is very
not fancy as in like you gotta wear a suit and tie type of shit. But like fancy as like, I mean, there's restaurants like, for example,
trying to bring up like an Applebee's, or are you trying
that's
to
get, what like, I'm thinking. I was going to say Applebee's. I was going to say Applebee's, and then you have Cheesecake. I'm trying to think of, I feel like Cheesecake Factory is fancier than Applebee's.
I would say sure they're on the same level. I don't think.
Is it the same level?
I feel like it. I don't think I go to a Cheesecake Factory and I'm like, oh, this Cheesecake Factory is nice. And I definitely don't go
a Chili's. I never really go. I've gone twice in my whole life.
I've gone once in my whole life, I believe. And yeah. I got this really good, I think it was an Oreo cheesecake or something like that. It was phenomenal. Mm-hmm. It was so good.
The last time I went, I didn't even order cheesecake.
What? Really?
Yeah, I mean, I took a couple pieces from my wife's. my wife and her family wanted to go, and I was like, I was thinking about getting cheesecake, but then there was so much food, I'm like, I want the food instead. So I got the food, and they got the cheesecake, and I just took pieces of their cheesecakes, because they're so huge.
Okay, well, you had some cheesecake then.
I had some.
Yeah.
But I took like 2-3 bites, because it's like, I'm not a super sweets person, so I have to depend. It depends. Like, I tried the Reese's one, and oh my god, it's like diabetes. I couldn't even eat it.
Yeah, it is. It's one of those things where it's like meant to be flashy, not necessarily good. Mm-hmm. Like, it's meant to be Instagram worthy, is what I call it. Like, that's Instagram.
It's hard. Like, it's annoying because I want to enjoy it, but it's so sweet that it upsets me that I can't enjoy it.
Well, and like I said, those are Instagram foods. Disney World has it. Like, restaurants have like that one meal that you buy that you're like, I'm going to post this on Instagram, but it's not. It doesn't taste good. It just looks very good. And I feel like that's with their cheesecakes. They look crazy, but then you take a bite and you're like, Jesus, I'll take 3 bites and then I'm done, because I'm going to go into a coma after this.
That'll be $30, please.
Was it expensive? I don't remember it being expensive.
Yes.
Was it?
Yes, Cheesecake Factory is expensive.
No, it's not. You're full of it. And I'm looking this up now. Cheesecake Factory prices, I think, is that'll probably bring it up, right? Prices.
And to be fair, the one I went to was in Jacksonville.
Well, Jacksonville's economy is always in the shit. Am I right, Floridians? Right? You guys suck. I'm just kidding. I love you, Florida. All right, let's see
the menu.
Okay, I see the menu. Is this gonna give me pricing though? I don't believe.
Yeah, it gives me pricing. Yeah.
No, it doesn't. Not what I'm looking at.
Oh, I literally just typed in menu from Google, like on Google. It says menu, and it shows me some. So, like an appetizer, the chicken pot stickers, almost $11.
Okay, yeah, that's an appetizer, Alex. That's for sure $10 at a restaurant. What restaurant are you going that's cheaper than that? Where are you going that's cheaper than this?
I don't go to restaurants. That's the issue.
All right, well, I feel like we've figured out the issue, Alex.
I mean,
you're not coming at all then. That $10 is like, that's appetizer for entree.
Where's the
at least $20? Let's
see, that's, I mean, I guess. Well, okay, no, for that's what I'm trying to find out. Because I understand an entree is a good $20, but like the cheesecake itself, like I'm not going to spend $20 on a piece of cheesecake.
Oh, I will. Happily. No, it's not $20. No. You're full of shit.
I don't know if it is or not. I'm looking for
you're
it.
You're just making stuff up now. you just told me to shut up. So it looks like the average cheesecake is $9. I'm looking at it. I'm looking at all the cheesecakes right now.
Okay.
God, there's a lot of them. Jesus. There's a Hershey's chocolate bar cheesecake. It's literally cake in two cakes in between like a bunch of frosting, and then on the outside there's Hershey's kisses stick to it. They're stuck to it with like frosting on top of it. It looks kind of nuts. Yeah, god, I'm still scrolling. Yeah, these are all like $9 to $10.
Yeah, let me see, what did I get?
I doubt it's there anymore. This looks brand new to me. None of this looks like the same.
I went a couple months ago, that's why. It was right before the pandemic.
Skinny-licious. What kind of
garbage? I got the crispy pineapple chicken and shrimp.
That sounds disgusting.
It was pretty good.
That sounds disgusting. Yeah, it looks like $15 to $20. Now, to be fair, Alex, how many people were with you? Because
four.
Yeah, so that gets expensive really quickly, especially if you're getting appetizers, entrees, and a dessert.
Yeah, imagine each person got a piece of cheesecake, not including me because I didn't want that shit. But actually, technically, somebody ordered 2 pieces so they can share. So like, that's $40 already. Mm-hmm. That's by 3 people, not including I got an entree, and I think 2 other people got entrees.
Well, to be fair, 4 people are there. It's different because it would just be me and my wife, and we're just getting our regular stuff. So I would probably drop probably $70 maybe between the two of us.
I can't do that.
I mean, you only live once, Alex. You gotta live on the edge sometimes. You gotta get cheesecakes. You just gotta live, man. You know what I'm saying?
Nah, man. I don't know. I guess I'm cheap, but if I'm going to a restaurant, I don't want to spend more than $50 on just 2 people.
Oh my God. Alex, where do you eat? Are you eating in the garbage can? Where are you spending $50 at a restaurant?
I look for the specials, like 2 for $20 special type of shit.
Oh no, I'm not doing that. I might as well not go out if I'm like not spending more than $50.
If the food's enjoyable, I mean this I don't care.
So is it like a pricing thing for you, or is it just like it has to be good for the money, or it doesn't matter how good it tastes, you're not spending the money?
No. I mean, it to me, all the foods taste good. It's just price.
I feel like your wife's going to make you go somewhere. You're full of it. The wife says,
for example,
going here to eat. You're saying yes. You're not saying how much it costs.
We prefer, like, out of all the restaurants in our area, we go to Ruby Tuesdays, if that tells you something.
I mean, you guys are known for wanting to save a good dollar. And I respect that. There's nothing wrong with being frugal, right?
Like my wife. My wife and I, we go to Ruby Tuesdays, and there'll be like specials, and me and her, we get either a salad bar or the entrees, and then we get a dessert. We don't spend more than $40.
You're insane.
Because we use coupons, and sometimes sometimes she only gets the salad bar, or sometimes like if there's a special, like I said, like there's like be like a 2 for $20 thing. I don't know.
I see. I'm the opposite. So if I'm going somewhere and I'm eating something for under $40, I might as well not go, because I feel like I'm not getting my money. Like, it's not a day out. I'm like trying to save money. So if I'm saving money, I'm just not gonna eat out. I'll just make like dinner or something.
Yeah, and see, I mean, it still tastes. The food's still really good. So I mean, like, I'm still, to me, it's worth the money, for even if it's that low.
Yeah, I'm not
money
saying
could it. Because it could be cheap and still taste as it could to me. Of like a $5 burger can taste the same as a $20 burger. It's gonna taste the same to me.
Yeah,
they're both gonna be good.
I see what you're saying. I get where you're.
I'd rather spend the $5, even though if I'm gonna get the same satisfaction, might as well save that $15.
Well, you see, if you're getting a $20 burger, it better be good. And I haven't spent $20 on a burger and been like, oh, I was gypped out of that money.
I think I spent, like, let's say it was 60 something, maybe $70 on food one time with my wife and I, and we weren't satisfied. We were like, eh, it was whatever.
Well, you, I don't know.
Like, we weren't.
Where are you eating at? Where's this place? Blow them up. Blow them up. Say the name.
I just can't. I can't remember.
Convenient for
you. I honestly.
Convenient for you.
I honestly,
you don't
I can't remember
the name, huh?
I can't remember a lot of things.
I remember. I'm going to tell a story, and Alex is going to be very upset. So I took me and my wife to New York one time. And we went to New York. By the way, this is a video game podcast. Anyways, we went to New York, and I was taking her to a trip. We were going to go to museums and see things, and I was going to a meet and greet as well, with Kinda Funny, to meet the stars of the show.
But see, okay, and first, you're going on a trip.
You're going to let me finish.
I mean, you're kind of
shut the
fuck
up. You're
going to spend the money.
You're going to shut the fuck up. You're going to let me finish, Alex.
audience, you see this?
So we wake up fresh on, I believe, the first or second day. We're loving life. We're like, let's try the what would you call the restaurant that's in the hotel, Alex? Like the in-house diner or whatever?
Yeah, I would just call it the inside restaurant.
And it was a very nice hotel. I got it for pretty cheap, surprisingly. It was like through Hotwire or something. Okay. And I go to get the breakfast, and I sit down and I ask for a table. We wait. We get the table. We sit down. I immediately get greeted, and I immediately get pampered to a degree I have never been pampered before. These two gentlemen are waiting on my every word. They're giving me every drink imaginable that I want. They immediately, I sit down, Alex, I've never even been asked this question. They go, would you like water and or juice? I was like, I'll take both. sparkling or regular? I'm like, fuck, I've never even had sparkling water. I'll just have regular water. I don't even know why it's sparkling. That tells you my life.
Where the hell did you go? The Marriott? Fuck.
Was it the Marriott? How did my,
no. No, that's in Atlanta.
Oh, yeah. I've stayed at the Marriott before, but no, I haven't been there.
It sounds like that this restaurant,
I think it was called food, The Loft.
That normally, you know, so normally a breakfast is included with this hotel. I'm assuming this was not included in the hotel.
Let me finish. So I sit down, I'm getting pampered. I get the drinks. We're given the menu. They give us
already
a few
when
minutes.
You get some motherfucker greeting you, you know it's not. It's already
Alex,
a price.
I am in, I believe, my like normal clothes. Picture me, Alex, in normal clothes. I now survey the area around me. There's not a single person suits. Not in a suit and dress, and I go, oh fuck.
Everybody looking at you like you're fucking, like you just came out of the streets.
Probably they're like, who let the scallions in? But anyways, I go to get to order. I get the Eggs Benedict. My wife gets, what did she get?
Already fucking just
waffles
pulling off
or something. The Eggs It might have been. It was something with bacon. I don't know. It was a fancy little breakfast thing she got.
Did it take Cumberbatch next to it?
Yes, it did. But I get the Eggs Benedict. First off, delicious. Alex, how much? At this moment, Alex, I'm eating the food. I go, huh? How much is this gonna cost? I wonder. And I look over at my wife and I'm like, I'm not gonna bring it up because I don't want to freak her out. So yeah, the guy comes over, he's like, you guys ready to go, like to check out? And I'm like, yes we are. And he goes and brings me this fucking... Alex, how much was the bill?
The way you made it sound, and it's so, because my wife, I'm gonna say over $100.
My wife got hot chocolate water.
Yep. Okay.
I got orange juice water. I got an Eggs Benedict, and she got a breakfast thing. A breakfast thing, we'll just say, is like $20 or something.
That Eggs Benedict, I'm assuming, is like $30 by itself.
Oh, and just so you know, at the audience at home is like, hey, why didn't you just look at the prices on the menu?
What menu?
No, there was a menu. Damn near did not have prices next to them.
Oh, for sure. That's exactly why.
I did not have prices next to him. I was in over my head to the very beginning. Oh, Alex, when I got that thing, that check looked at me and it said $160 for two basically entrees and some drinks and some hot chocolate.
And guess what? Alex, you could have made all that for less than $20 at home.
It wouldn't have been that taste that good. Alex, I will tell you that I did not regret a single penny.
So are you doubting your cooking skills?
No, but it was cooked with such perfect, and it's not just that, it's the pampering as well. I was really
No, I understand. You're paying for the service. Like, yeah, you're not paying for the food.
For sure. Like the food probably didn't cost that much. But Alex, by God.
Look, if I were to pass by and started walking in, and I see this motherfucker start greeting me, and I see somebody pampering me, I'm like, all right, now we got, even before I get some water, because they're going to charge me $20 for the glass of water, and it's like $1 per ice cube. Let me stand up and leave.
The water was $9. And the juice was also $9. I usually
there's complimentary water. It would have, like, no.
Fuck no, there wasn't. Not in New York. And honestly, I'm probably telling it, and people in New York are like, that's nothing. Like, that's probably nothing. But yeah, that took me by surprise. I was like, I budgeted way more money than I needed to for that trip. So I was like, it is fine. And it was worth it. And we almost went back, Alex. I will say that. We almost went back. It was,
whoa.
I know.
I would have told you. Oh.
I'm being honest, dude. It was that good. I know you're like, you're crazy. If you had what I had, you would not have doubted. You would have at least paused. But I do understand. To a lot of people, I sound insane. That was a special trip, though, like you brought up at the beginning.
Look, I loved Disney's Cruise Line. I loved their entrees and their foods. if I would have gotten like my normal,
yeah, ladies and gentlemen. First off, this is a man who's complaining. They went to a cruise line for a week. Take everything this man's saying with a huge grain of fucking salt.
Fuck you! All right, it was a honeymoon, and we saved for it. So, but if they had a restaurant and I would have had to pay for that, and it would have been over $100. I wouldn't have done that. I'm telling you right now.
It's that weird thing where it has to be renowned. You know what I mean? Like, it has to have a gravitas about it, right?
If I see that bill and it's over $80, I'll be like, why?
Oh, you're Karen in that bitch up, Alex. You're being a Karen. Like, why was this over $10 than what it was on the menu?
I got a coupon, but and it says it's still good.
I have an active coupon. It was buy one, get one. Oh, that reminds me, Alex. This is the ECG Risk Gaming Podcast. This is where we discuss the previous week in gaming and maybe go over a topic.
20 minutes ranting about food.
Hey, we're having a good time. You can, of course, check us out on every single podcast service of your choice every single Friday. We come to you every Friday also on YouTube. If you enjoy our content there, then you can, of course, go over to patreon.com/EGGamers. You can give us a dollar that goes towards my very, very, very expensive taste in food. How about that? Not really. It keeps the mics on, the lights on, and Alex's dogs fed. Alex, very light news this week. And I mean very. Not much to talk about. There's a couple rumors swirling around. There's a couple very exciting announcements to discuss. But of course, before we begin the actual news story, we would like to ask Alex one question before we start. Alex, what? No, I'm not going to do that one. Alex, should the new consoles get delayed? Now, you may be asking, why are you asking Alex this? This has been the hubbub around the gaming space over the last week. Should the new consoles get delayed? Now, of course, we are speaking about the Xbox Series X, Xbox Series S, and the PS5. Should they be delayed past 2020, holiday 2020, into 2021, maybe around March, where the Switch was originally released? The reasoning is, of course, with COVID, maybe strenuating people's funds to be able to buy these for a number of reasons. Other economic issues, or maybe the launch lineups not being very compelling to the normal audience member. And for various other reasons, you could argue that they should be and maybe delayed. Alex, I wanted to bring this to the table. Why or why not should the consoles be delayed?
I don't...
I think it's an interesting question, especially if you bring in COVID, especially if you bring in the economy. Like, there's so many factors.
I don't think it should.
Okay.
I think it should stick with its release.
I think so too.
Yes, I understand that people are going to be kind of like in a hard spot because of this whole situation that's happening. Mm-hmm. But that's why I think it shouldn't be delayed, because we've gone through so much this year. We need what's the word?
Like a light at the end of the tunnel.
We need a pick me up at the end of the year. You know, we're like, we need something to be excited for. This year has been really hard to a lot of people, and so I feel like something at the end of the tunnel, like you said, should be hell yeah, man, I'm excited for this. This is what I've been waiting for. Just it could put a smiles on people's faces.
Right now, the U.S. is the biggest market for the consoles. Of course, I'm not disparaging big markets as like Japan and Europe. I'm just saying the U.S. is generally the biggest market for these systems. If we're taking into account the current economy right now, we are at, technically, the U.S. is at a rate at 8.4% roughly where unemployment is. That's a good bit. That's almost 10%. That's a lot of people without a job. Now there are 330 million people living in America. If we factor in people with usable incomes that could reasonably buy a $500 system at launch, that of course number goes much, much lower. Generally, that person is over 18 to 20. And then if they have an actual disposable income, that number gets lower and lower. But not too many systems are honestly coming out, and I'm very curious on what we're actually going to be looking at for actual units. I don't think they should be late, but I do think people really need to be wary when they announce when these are going to start coming out.
No,
these
for
are,
sure.
These are going to be announced, and I really, Alex, I really think within the first week, the units will be taken, and the allocations will end.
I feel like there's very limited, and not everybody's going to be able to pre-order one.
Yeah, I'm honestly very worried, and I'm in a position where I could probably very easily pre-order one, but I am still very worried that I may not get one, and that's terrifying. Especially with weird PlayStation, you got the, you can sign up for the notification to buy it on the website thing that happened last week. If you missed it, you could, PlayStation sent out an email that you could sign up through the website. If you put in your PSN ID, they would enter you into like a lottery system or something. That it most likely, the more money you have spent on the store, most likely you'll be given a system to be able to pre-order. And things like that really make me worried. Like, how many systems do you have? Like, how many systems are we actually getting?
Well, I just don't feel like that's kind of fair either, because what about the people who like can't do that but really want to? Like, it's not, I don't seem like it's a fair thing.
Yeah, maybe it's only a small location. Maybe it's something they want to do only for a specific amount. Maybe this is something they're just test marketing. They're not necessarily want to try and do. Now, they did, there was the rumor / I think it was confirmed that Sony is making 10 million by March 2021, I want to say. I believe within the first 6 months they'll have 10 million, or was it 5 million? I do not quite remember, but I know currently Microsoft is sitting on a million Series X's. I believe so. Okay. I believe so. So, I mean, productions have already started. We're just waiting on price and pre-order, and price is something we can complain about all in together. We still don't know how much these things are going to cost.
It's going to be $600.
Alex, I would have disagreed with you months ago, and the closer we get to this without them saying anything, the more interesting it's getting, because why would you not say it's 500? Why? Well, there's no reason to not say your price is $500. You know the other guy is probably also going to be $500. So the only reason it would give you pause if it's not $500. Alex, are we looking at two systems that possibly are going to be $600? $599.
Oh, most likely, yeah.
This is
That's exactly what's
going to be. Insane. I do not think it will actually. I think they want them at $600, but they will sell them at $500. I'm very curious if anyone's going to see a loss from that. I could actually see PlayStation and Microsoft seeing a loss from the systems because they're not making any actual money off the sale. Because that's probably how much it actually costs to make them, so they're probably breaking even. Which, of course, that's not very good to your financial holders in the company, but you at least get systems out there at a reasonable price of $500.
Yeah.
I hope 500 is still the plan.
I mean, of course, we always think hope is 500, but I think it's going to be 6. And the Series S, I think it's going to be like 4.
I could see the Series S being 4. It would be phenomenal if they're 3, but I think that's way too crazy.
I think that's too low.
I think it's too low because of what's in it. I think there's 7 exactly. teraflops in it, if I remember correctly, which is 2 more than this 1X has, I think. I could be messing that up, but that should be close. And that's incredible, but also that's going to make it more expensive, unfortunately. Sticking on the PlayStation 5 trail, Alex, there was a Ubisoft support page up. This was garnered. The first came to my attention with the Twitter on Twitter from Wario64, a very, very good insider in the gaming space. So, stated from a Ubisoft support FAQ, which is very strange, and don't know why they were particularly answering this question, but an FAQ page reads, transitioning PlayStation 4 titles to next-gen versions. How does upgrading from PS4 to PlayStation 5 work? Again, this is on Ubisoft. This is on their website. This answer, as part of their next the next-gen upgrade process, PlayStation offering a number of features designed to help you move from PlayStation 4 to PlayStation 5. PS4 players will be able to join multiplayer games with PS5 players. Backwards compatibility will be available for supported PS4 titles, but will not be possible for PS3, PS2, and PS1 games. We also have information on the next gen for the Xbox Series X, which you can, of course, go over and read more about that. But that was taken down moments later.
Really?
For obvious reasons. Oh, yes, yeah. The FAQ, like that question, was taken down. You can, I'm sure representatives at PlayStation emailed them and said, take it down. And they did.
So the PS2 games, for example, like the ones that we paid for on PS4, we're not going to be able to play those on our PS5.
Great question, Alex. I don't know why Sony doesn't come out and explain backwards compatibility. I honestly think they just
because it doesn't work.
I don't think they know. I don't think they know if it either it doesn't work or they don't know how to make it work. Either of those
I don't think it's true backwards compatibility. They keep saying that it's backwards compatible with PS4. I think it's going to be the like the PS Now situation where you're streaming the PS4 games that you own.
Thing about this, Alex, why is it such a hard thing for them to just talk about this?
It's crazy. Sony, it's not even that hard to have.
Just say, I mean, Xbox it doesn't to. Or it does. This could have already been answered months ago.
They're scared that they're going to lose people if they say no right now and then they can get it to work later. I think they're saying yes so that they can try to get it to work before it does release.
Alex, I am a firm believer of the Band-Aid. You rip it off. You do not slowly peel the Band-Aid off. If they would have ripped this
PlayStation likes doing that.
That's PlayStation's favorite thing. If they would have ripped that backwards compatibility Band-Aid off way earlier, we would not be doing this weird FAQ nonsense. We should not be learning that the PlayStation isn't backwards compatible from a FAQ on a Ubisoft website. Like, this is...
Look, Ubisoft saw is like, all right, motherfuckers, you guys are taking way too long to answer this. We'll do this for you.
Hey, man, I think a lot of people at home are like, oh, that wouldn't happen. Like, they're executives. Ubisoft might have had issues with their customer base with asking these questions and they couldn't answer them. Maybe they did put this up.
Yeah.
Intentionally knowing that they were breaking some sort of small NDA they had with PlayStation, or at least muddling waters with them, and wanted to put it out there like, hey, your games won't work on PlayStation. Now, Alex, I will say it works on Xbox. It does, right? We know almost every game will work on an Xbox. At least Xbox One wise. PS4 still does that weird thing where we're expecting the top, 100 games to work on PS5 from PS4. Some crazy, weird marketing word that they tried to do.
Look, I don't even think all PS3 games are even on PS Now to play on PS4.
Oh, no. When
you can have the chance and say that you have all the PS3 games available to play, like as Xbox does, then I'll believe them. But right now, PS5, no. It's not backwards compatible, in my opinion.
I think if it was, they would have already said it. You don't hold back
good news. I feel like it's not working.
You don't hold back good news. If you had good news, you would have shared it already. And if it is, hey, I don't know why you let people crap on you for so long, because I would have already said it. I have never been so excited for next gen, but so tired of current gen before. And it's not even the systems. I'm talking about the conversations, because no one is saying anything. It's like we're just asking like questions to a wall that will never talk back to us. And it's just so annoying.
It's bad to say, and it hurts us in a downfall, but I kind of hope that it's not backwards compatible, just so they can get bite that bullet.
Just so it's over with,
and they can, and just so they can, like, you know, you guys prolong this too far, and this is what you get. Like, you deserve that bullet. So mm-hmm. like, you know, if anything, I feel like they deserve to where like, oh, it's not gonna work.
Yeah, no, I get it. I mean, I understand the lack of pity, because it's one of those that's like, you guys kind of wrote this off yourselves. You could have already had this finished.
Well, because doing this, I mean, it just makes it to where like they're losing trust in their fan base and stuff.
Yeah. And I will reiterate, I'm buying a PS5 at launch. We're the easy ones.
Oh, yeah.
We're the easy guys to win over. This should be easy for us to, like, it's that's really telling if it's making us upset. But who knows? Yeah, maybe backwards compatibility isn't a big deal. But to me, it is.
Yeah, no, like, I mean, at first, I wasn't, like, really caring, because I was like, oh, I mean, I'm just going to play for certain games and stuff. But, like, I kind of, like, what would have been excited for if we knew it was working.
Yeah,
but I don't know. Because I was planning on trying to get both systems, but now, I mean, I think I'm just gonna wait on PS5. I don't know.
I mean, yeah, that's one of those things too, where it's like, I'll just wait, and there's nothing wrong with that.
Because I mean, I can like try to afford both, but like now I just feel like. I'm just like, you know what? I know I can afford one of them. I'm just going to stick to one right now.
Got it. Moving on. There was a dope Nintendo Direct, Mario Direct thing. Nintendo's weird. But they did announce a lot of cool things. I'm going to start with the banger, and we're going to go through all the other weird decisions. Yes. Super Mario 3D All-Stars has been announced. These are optimized versions of the 3D Mario games, including Super Mario 64, Super Mario Sunshine, and, of course, Super Mario Galaxy. These are all coming to Nintendo Switch in one glorious, sexy little package.
Yes.
In addition to having higher resolutions than original versions, the game has been optimized for smoother gameplay experiences on Nintendo Switch. Super Mario 3D All-Stars also includes an in-game music player mode to play the songs from all three games. Players can also listen to music on their Nintendo Switch systems when the screen is off. And limited production of Super Mario 3D All-Stars launches exclusively to the Nintendo Switch family of systems on September 18th and will be available until approximately March 31st, 2020. Alex, I want to focus on the end part there.
Oh, for sure.
It will be available September 18th and will end approximately March 31st, 2021. Alex, I can hear the boardroom now. We need to increase our numbers from the Q3 ending in Q4. All right, yep. Let's re-release Super Mario 3D All-Stars and make it to where you have to buy it before their Q4 of the fiscal year ends. This couldn't be more obvious than what they're doing. They're like, we need more money, so we're just gonna re-release these games and boost up our numbers, because COVID apparently destroyed Nintendo with their great game release. I don't think Animal Crossing was meant to be the only game. I think they had plans for something, whether it but be it, the Metroid game.
I feel like
or
it
something.
Did way better than. If we didn't have COVID, I don't feel like that game would have done as good.
Oh, no, of course not. But, I mean, it would have done phenomenal. But I think COVID, of course, made it even better. I think every game did better because of COVID, because people are at home.
For sure.
But this is very strange. And I know it says launches a limited production. But, like, they're going to take it off the online store, too, which is weird.
What they'll do, that you know, they'll get rid of the package and they'll probably sell it separately each.
Ding ding ding, Alex, these are probably all going up separately for 40-60 bucks each. No doubt that's gonna happen.
March you're gonna have to get them all separate.
Yep, I have zero doubt that's gonna happen. These are gonna be way more expensive than 60 bucks after that. That is the Nintendo way. But Alex, are you excited for this? This is what you've been wanting, right?
Oh, yes.
You get to play Sunshine.
This is
again,
why I bought a Switch.
This is why you bought a Switch.
Yep. Yeah, originally when we first announced the Switch, they said GameCube games were going to be playable, and guess what? We've yet to get it. This is the first GameCube game that we've gotten, I think.
I don't know. Technically we're getting a re-release of Pokemon Snap, I guess. But I don't know if that counts. This is cool. Yeah. I'm excited about this. I want to play Galaxy.
And it's 2 weeks away.
And only 2 weeks away. And I want to play Super Mario 64. So I'm excited for this.
Same. Now, you said you're those. You didn't say you were excited to play Sunshine. What are you? Are you not wanting to play that one?
Oh God, like, I can't serious. Get back anything by you, Alex. I'm not excited to play it. I will try out the game. But nothing I've seen about it makes me go, I want to play that.
Okay, so it doesn't really, like, for what you've seen, it doesn't really excite you.
No, but I'm not afraid to try it, though.
Okay. It does look weird. I'm not going to lie to you. But, like, as you play it, I feel like it gets more fun because there's, you know, all these puzzles and stuff that you have to use your water gun thing. Yeah. It makes it pretty fun.
Okay, I'm excited to try this out. I am. That will probably be what I get. I'll probably try that first, just to we can maybe make a fun video. Like my first time playing.
Well, it's gonna be funny because you're watching it hooked.
I hope I do. Honestly, I really do. I would be happy to get a new Mario game to love.
Yeah.
All right. Now
that's how I am with Galaxy. I've never really played Galaxy.
Oh, I'm excited for you to try it. It's really fun. Now we get to the weird section of the Nintendo, because it's not Nintendo unless it gets weird and
out of nowhere. I'm kind of excited for this next one.
Mario Kart Live Home Circuit. This is created within partnerships of Velen Studios. Mario Kart Live Home Circuit brings the fun of the Mario Kart series into the real world by using Nintendo Switch or Switch Lite to race against opponents using a physical kart. The physical kart represents boosts in-game and the real world. Stops when hit with an item and can be affected in different ways depending on the race. Players place gates to create a custom course layout in their home, where the only limit is their imagination. Race against Koopalings in Grand Prix. Unlock a variety of course customization and costumes for Mario and Luigi. And play with up to 4 players in local multiplayer modes. Mario Kart Live Home Circuit, which is available to a Mario set or Luigi set, launches October 6th at a suggested retail price of $100. So hope you like it enough for $100.
So I mean, I assume you get the game, which is $60, and then you're paying for the little RC car, which is $40.
And to note, you're getting one RC car, so you are either getting the Mario set or the Luigi set.
No, for sure. Yeah, yikes. You get one RC car, and then you get all the little checkpoints.
Yikes. Now, this does look cool. I will admit, if I had a munchkin...
Big enough house?
That too. But if I had, like, a child, I for sure would buy this. We would be having so much fun with this thing, racing around the house, bothering...
No, I'm sure once my kid gets older, she would want to try this.
Yeah. I don't have much else to say about that. It looks cool. It's a cool idea. I like Nintendo because they do weird stuff, and this is a weird thing.
I'm interested in how it's gonna work.
Yeah, me too. It looks like it's just gonna be like it'll respond to like in-game commands when it gets hit or something.
Yeah,
I assume. Moving on to something very specific to me, Game & Watch Super Mario Brothers. This is of course the original Game & Watch series, which is a very very old thing from like the 80s. You can use the original Game & Watch Mario Brothers, so Super Mario Bros. And Super Mario Bros. Lost Level, and it's a special version of Ball with a Mario Makeover, and it's also it's hard to explain what it looks like. Google it if you can, but it's basically a square. Like think of a Game Boy Advance, but make it a mini square, and that's what it looks like. This is just, I think it's more of like just a for fun thing. This is Game & Watch Super Mario Brothers launch.
Think of Game Boy Micro, just a little bigger.
Yeah, basically. Like it's very weird looking. I'll probably buy this just to have it as a collectible item. But yeah, this looks fun. Now to something that is very, very, very much for me, because this is one of my favorite Mario games. Super Mario 3D World plus Bowser's Fury. Multiplayer Mayhem pounces onto the Nintendo Switch. This enhanced version of Super Mario 3D World, which originally launched on Wii U, features co-op gameplay both online and through local multiplayer, and a variety of creative levels. Additional details about what new things this game has to offer will be revealed later. Super Mario 3D World Bowser's Fury launches on Nintendo Switch on February 12th, 2021. And there will be two new amiibos, Cat Mario and Cat Peach, little cat versions of them. I'm very excited about that. I cannot wait for that version to come out. I will be definitely buying
that. I played only a little bit of 3D World, and I was enjoying it.
It's very fun.
I never finished it.
I finished it. I played it all the way through. The last, like, world is so cool looking, and I'm excited to get back there. It's going to be so fun. Now, speaking of weird, this was out of nowhere, and I didn't think this would ever happen. So this is Super Mario Brothers 35. Welcome to Super Mario Bros. With 35 players. In this competitive online battle game, 35 players will compete to be the last Mario standing or running. Enemies defeated will be sent to other players' courses, but that also works the other way around. Players can activate special items to try and outpace their opponents. Super Mario Bros. 35 launches October 1st as a digital-only game exclusive to Nintendo Switch Online members. This game will be playable until March 31st, 2021.
That last part right there. So digital game only, meaning you have to buy the game.
No, right? It's included with your membership. So game if you have, oh, okay, if you have Switch Online,
exclusive too. Okay.
Yeah, you do not buy it.
I thought it would only let. I thought it would only let you buy the game if you had the membership. That's why I was confused.
Oh no! It is. It's built into the service, and the game will last until March 31st because it's dumb. That's dumb.
Gotcha.
That's dumb, but whatever. Nintendo is gonna Nintendo, man. I have nothing much to say about that. It looks cool. I'll play it for probably like 2 sessions and then never play it again. But it looks cool. Super Mario, what is this? Oh, yeah, this is the original Super Mario All-Stars, the classic Super NES game that includes upgraded versions of Super Mario Brothers, Super Mario Brothers Lost Levels, Super Mario Bros. 2, and Super Mario Bros. 3 with enhanced 16-bit graphics is joining the catalog. It's a game available in Switch Online. That is already available if you want to go jump on and play that. I'm very excited. I will be playing Super Mario 3 and Lost Levels. I'm not a huge Mario 2 fan, but I will be playing 1 and 3.
Yeah.
There are, of course, going to be a bunch of events. If it's a Nintendo game, it has some sort of Mario tie-in. Later this year, Super Smash Bros. Ultimate will have an in-game online tournament featuring Super Mario Series fighters, stages, and items. A 35th anniversary-themed Ninja Speedruns course is coming to the Super Mario Maker 2 game in November. That's weird. There's going to be 35th anniversary themed merchandise in the Nintendo New York store and store.nintendo.com. Mario Kart Tour will have a Super Mario Kart event with special appearances by Mario, Donkey Kong Jr. From the original Super Mario game. And then Splatoon is getting some stuff. I don't even know what's... I don't play Splatoon. I can't speak of it. And there's a bunch of other things that we're not going to go over, but it's a lot of just tie-ins to other things.
My cat is being so loud.
Is that the cat? I couldn't tell if that was the cat or your daughter.
Oh, my cat is in the hallway freaking the hell out.
Yeah, that cat sounds like it is the definition of freaking out. Well, Alex handles his cat situation, I will go and handle this Prince of Persia rumor.
Oh, so go ahead.
When I say rumor, it's basically been confirmed. Ubisoft Forward will have a showcase on September 10th, promising new games and big news. And they will, of course, re-feature the game formerly known as Gods and Monsters, now known as Immortals Phoenix Rising. Because Gods and Monsters, Alex, was too easy to remember, so we had to make it Immortals Phoenix Rising. What? Anyways, moving on to the actual story. Speaking on the latest Triple Click podcast, Bloomberg reporter Jason Schreier claimed Ubisoft is planning to use the event to, quote, announce a bunch of games like the Prince of Persia remake that was leaked a couple weeks ago, end quote. Retailer Max.com GT recently published and then pulled a listing for Prince of Persia remake for PlayStation 4 and Nintendo Switch. Alex, have you any... Do you care about this? I played Prince of Persia as a child, so I barely remember
I never played it, so I don't even know if it's good or not.
I played it... I barely remember the game, but I do remember liking it.
I've heard people liking the game. I just never played it.
I am excited, especially if it's a cool remake, to actually play it. So I, you know, as an adult, and see if I like it. I think I will, but I'm excited. I will be waiting on bated breath. We know it's coming out. Ubisoft always leaks their things. They are terrible over there with that. So they leak everything. So we know that September 10th, there you go, fans, you're getting your Prince of Persia game. Speaking of Immortals Phoenix Rising earlier, the release date and screenshots seemingly were leaked. This is IGN by Adam Bankhurst. So according to the Microsoft Store, Ubisoft's Immortals Phoenix Rising, previously known as Gods and Monsters, will be released December 3rd, 2020 on at least Xbox One, because that was all that was verified, because of course, because it was a Microsoft Store link. But yeah, that was leaked. I guess that's probably true, right? I don't see why else it would be put up there, but this looks there's some screenshots if you want to look it up. That was leaked. A bunch of screenshots were leaked too. It looks kind of cool.
Yeah,
it gives me like, Kingdoms of Amalur vibes.
When they showed it originally, when it was Gods and Monsters, it piqued my interest. I just hope that they like the game wasn't changed too much.
I mean, it looks pretty different.
Yeah.
At least from what I remember, it looks pretty different.
I mean, I just hope it's good.
I'm excited to see what it is. Curious if it's gonna be good.
I mean, because this is by the creators of Assassin's Creed, isn't it?
Odyssey, yes. I believe it was Odyssey. They wanted to use the... Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry about that, guys. They wanted to use the information they learned about studying the Greek mythology so much, so they wanted to make this game.
Mm-hmm. God, man, I want Valhalla.
Yeah. We're so close. November. We're
I'm in that Vikings mode because I just finished the show Vikings.
Right.
Oh, I'm just like, I want to just like do the raids and stuff.
Yeah. Alex, The Witcher 3 is coming to Next Generation. This is over on CD Projekt Red's Twitter. A visually and technically enhanced version of the game will be available for purchase for PC and Next Gen consoles, and as a free update for owners of the game on PC, Xbox One, and PlayStation 4. Very exciting. CD Projekt Red always takes care of us. They are constantly pampering us with new DLC for free, new upgrades, and this is just another example of just that.
It says that the upgrade is going to have the ray tracing and everything too.
Yes, it will have ray tracing. I'm being curious and see what that looks like.
Because I've never really seen anything about ray tracing, so I'm excited to see.
Yeah, I've only seen the videos that it's like, oh, this is Minecraft. Ray tracing. Like, I've only seen stuff like that, but to see it in person, it's very exciting.
No, for sure.
Alex, that's what we got for the news for the week. That's, like I said, it was very light news week, so let's relax, kick back. Alex, what do you have queued up? Now, before you say what you have queued up, I wanted to end the show with a little peek into what we've been playing, because we didn't cover that at the beginning of the show. I wanted to have your thoughts on raids, specifically in Destiny 2. We were playing Destiny 2 over the week. And you had your first, I mean, that at least your recently first beginning to end raid almost, right? You've played a
completion,
lot of...
no, because I've done a couple raids where I've gotten all the way close to the boss, but it just winds up being like frustrating and at the end of the night, and we never finished the raid.
Yeah,
this is the first one that I've actually completely finished the raid.
So, as someone new to the concept of raiding, Alex, what did you think of your experience? Did you have fun? What do you think of the mechanics?
I enjoyed it. I like the puzzles. It does help when everybody knows what they're doing.
Yeah.
Because you can have, like me, I was new. I mean, I have somebody trying to explain me the thing, and you know, I'll make mistakes, and you know, it's just making the raid go a little longer because I'm making the mistakes. But after you get it down, it's fun. You get those exotics. You get the triumphs. It's awesome.
Yeah, it's really cool. I wouldn't say I'm a seasoned raider, but I have definitely done a lot of raids.
I'm
definitely experienced. I'm pretty proficient and guarded now because I've done it so much.
Yeah,
because everything up to the boss is really easy. The boss is the hardest part of that encounter.
Technically, we've always been experienced because with D1, we did all the raids in D1.
That's true, yeah.
In D2, I mean, I've done Leviathan on PlayStation, but I've yet to do it on my Xbox.
Yeah. Shout out to Oryx. That was a fun raid.
That was fun, yeah.
That was so cool. Shooting him with the...
The only one I've never even touched was Crown of Sorrows. I've never touched that one.
I've gone to the boss. I don't remember if I beat him or not, but I got to the boss. It's a very mechanic heavy raid, but it's not too bad.
I think I started it one time. I don't know if it, I don't know, because I think it somehow it let me, and I started it, and I was it, like, I remember it starting, and there's like a big hole in the ground, and I just like dropped, and there was like so many enemies, and I'm like, well, not for me.
Yeah, you have to like pass a buff around that it's basically kind of like doing the moat thing. But instead of a moat, you shoot this big ball, and it transfers who has the buff that will destroy the shields and stuff.
Gotcha, gotcha.
So it's very similar, but it is interesting. It's different, too. I like it. I like raids. They're very fun. It's fun getting a group of people together and just, like, destroying a raid or like, doing funny stuff. And you're really having fun with the people. You're not really worried about the raid too much. And
no, yeah. That's always fun, too. You're just having a good time with everybody.
Yeah. That's always fun. Alex, to get back to the original point, at the end of the show, every achiever knows, we like to wind down. We like to talk about what we're going to be doing for the rest of the week until we see you again. Alex, what do you have queued for the week? This could be, of course, a show, a game, a movie, or even a play. It could be anything. What do you have queued up that you're excited for the week?
So we're going to keep playing some Destiny.
Of course.
I mean, we are definitely going to do some Trials this weekend.
Yes, our first Trials. I have not played Trials in a long time, so this will be...
I think I've done it... I think I played it once.
I think
and
you
I've
played it
played...
once with me, yeah.
Yeah.
But that's it.
But what we are going to do, we're going to assemble, my friend.
We're assembling. So we are going to play Marvel's The Avengers over the week. We will, of course, as soon as we finish, offer a review and spoiler cast to you guys. So be prepared for that. Be ready for that. Just so everyone knows, I did get it for free. I did not pay for this game. I, of course, the first thing I did because I'm Elijah, I got on and spent $20 on a upgrade pack to get, like, special stuff. because I Alex, I know you don't feel this way, but I sometimes do. Not paying for something is strange. So I like to at least give them a little bit of money. Like, so I gave them like $20 for the deluxe upgrade. Did you see this? So you get like a little you get like a little outfit pack, and you get some nameplates and nothing crazy, but it was something I could easily like, here you go. Like, here's some keep the DLC coming, buddy. All right. Did we go over the leak that we did, right? That was like a few weeks ago. We went over the leak of the Avengers coming, right? Yeah, we did. We for sure did. We covered that on the show.
What are you talking about?
Remember the character list for Marvel Avengers leaked? Do you remember this?
I think so.
I'm pretty sure we went over like what's coming out. Did you see that Kate Bishop is gonna be Hawkeye, by the way?
Oh, no, I didn't see that.
Yeah, so in the last war table we got, Alex, they announced that you're going to be playing as Kate Bishop trying to get Clint back on the Avengers side. So that's going
to
be
I'm assuming he's Ronin?
It looks like he's probably working with bad people. I don't know if they've used the word Ronin, but that'd be cool.
Okay. Yeah.
And they did also announce that Black Panther could be a addition. Of course, we went over last week, we did lose Chadwick Boseman, and they announced on the recent one that they were, of course, already planning Black Panther stuff, but they delayed the official announcement to honor him and not make it feel like we're trying to capitalize on anything. So they didn't announce that.
No, not yet, for sure.
So we are getting something Black Panther. I assume a character, hopefully. The rumor was there's going to be a raid in Wakanda. So hopefully there's some more stuff about that.
Yeah.
But yeah, so Kate Bishop will be the first playable DLC character. So whenever that DLC comes out, we'll be playing as her version of Hawkeye.
And then we'll try out Spider-Man whenever he comes out.
Yeah, that was spring of next year. I don't know when.
Oh, dang. Is it really?
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's next year. It's next year for sure.
Goodness gracious.
It's no time soon. It is one of those things where, are we going to be playing it then? You know what I'm saying?
That's my thing. I'm like, Jesus, at that point.
It is, yeah. It's a weird thing where it's like, are we going to be playing this game? I think so.
At that point, I'm just going to be too excited for God of War 2.
Stop it, Alex. Stop it. You know what you're doing. You know what you're doing, Alex. I can't find it, but there was a leak. They data mined it, basically, and mm-hmm. found a bunch of leaked characters. I'm almost positive we went over this. But I just wanted to look at them again. People like She-Hulk and War Machine were in the coding of the game. And those are like, and those are easy alternatives. You could just change the costume of Hulk to She-Hulk, and that's an easy like, switch.
Gotcha.
Stuff like that. Like, oh, that's like someone you could probably like get that way.
That's cool.
All right, Alex. Anything else that you got queued up? We got Avengers. I'm very excited for that. We're gonna be playing. I'm gonna be playing a lot of that. I have more raids to do.
Same. I do want to go and do the raids with you. I am going to be getting the Linkin Park pack from Beat Saber. I want to go back to Beat Saber.
Yes, I need to do that. I need to get on there and download that just so I can Linkin Park it up. Because, my God, Beat Saber is so good. And it is such a good workout, too.
Oh, for sure, dude. Like, if I can't do, like, really exercise, I'll just get on there and, like, you know, it's a kind of like of an excuse to play a game but work out kind of at the same time.
Alex, thank you for dealing with all of this. And thank 20
minutes of how you go through food.
Yes. That was pertinent that we went over that. And thank you, Achievers, for listening to this. This has been your Easy Achievers Gaming Podcast for the week of September 4th. Thank you again for joining us. We had a great time, and we hope you did too. If you liked us, again, remember, like, comment, subscribe, and share with a friend. Remember, you can, of course, head over to patreon.com/EasyAchievers. You can give us a dollar. That, of course, keeps your mics on, keeps our lights on, and it keeps Alex's dog just on the brink of starvation. Not complete starvation, off the brink.
We can't have that.
Take pictures of I'll take pictures of Alex's dogs, and I'm going to play that commercial song. And I'm gonna be like, if you don't support us on Patreon, these dogs are gonna die.
for just a penny.
Just was it a dollar divided into 30? That's like barely 2 cents a day. So for 2 cents a day, you can support us on patreon.com/EasyAchievers.
Yep.
I think it's like 3 cents. Sorry, 3 cents a day. Something like that. But yeah, thank you guys so much. We will go play Avengers and more Destiny 2. And until then, go achieve.
Go achieve.